Привет, меня зовут Фолькер Симонис, я работаю в SAP в Германии, в отделе, который разрабатывает саповский JVM. Мы лицензировали HubSpot от Sun, сейчас Oracle, и сделали порт на многие другие платформы, как Itanium, PowerPC, Z Architecture, HP UX, AAX. Мы тоже работаем в OpenJDK, мы там сделали PowerPC порт, AAX порт в OpenJDK. Вот. И да, немножко русский понимаю, но сейчас доклад по-английски. So intrinsics, the definition of intrinsics is like it's a built-in, it's a compiler built-in, it's a function which the compiler pretends to know better than the programmer what this function do, and he can optimize it. This is actually the definition from Wikipedia. So there are a lot of intrinsics in different compilers. For example, to improve the performance, GCC intrinsifies B0, printf, stringed applications, mathematical functions. Also in Java, we have intrinsics for square root or array copy, things like that. But the intrinsics are also used for functionality which cannot otherwise be expressed in the language itself. So for example, modern CPU architectures have support for transactional memory, but in C++ there is no correspondence, there is no functionality for transactional memory. So GCC has again some built-ins or intrinsics which you can use to get this functionality of transactional memory. In Java, for example, the unsafe class is, for example, a method allocate instance, which allocates an object without calling the constructor. So this is actually not possible in Java, but with this unsafe method, you can do it. And this method is intrinsified, so you cannot express that in Java. Also, recently, a new method was added to thread. It's called onSpinWait. It's checked 285 from Azul, which just inserts spin weights in spin loops, if that's possible on a CPU. The third use case for intrinsics is just give the programmer access to CPU instructions. So most of the time when new CPUs come out and they have new instructions, like vector instructions, for example, compiler writers are not so fast that the new compilers already generate code for these instructions, but it's easier to provide intrinsics so programmers can use them to make use of the functions. So for example, in Java we have unsafe load fence, which gives you access to memory synchronization routine. So let's start with a very simple example. Hello world, and for this conference I have intrinsified the say hello function. So let's see how that works. So I have just written an interpreter intrinsic, so we run in interpreted mode the hello world program, and it takes like 7 milliseconds and prints previous jailbreak. So now we enable the intrinsic with XX JPoint. And you see it's of course much faster because we don't do all these calls. We will look at the implementation a little later. But of course intrinsifying also brings problems which I want to show you in this talk. So for example, when you now change the Java program for the next conference, and I write Joker, and now I recompile the Hello World program. When we run it, the normal Java program, it now prints the previous Joker, of course. But when we have the intrinsic, so we pretended to know what this function does and have optimized it in the virtual machine, then of course it will still print JPoint. So this is something we have to be aware of. So this was just the first example. So what other problems do we have with intrinsics? So Another problem is observability. So maybe you know that Java has a functionality called bytecode instrumentation, which allows you to dynamically change the bytecode at runtime, so you can add arbitrary bytecodes to Java methods when their classes are loaded. And this functionality is often used by agents, profilers, and code coverage tools, and so on. And you can this is implemented in Java lang instrument, and this bytecode instrumentation is loaded with the Java agent options on the command line. I have put an implementation of such a small Java agent in this code. We won't go through this code. I will just show you how it works, but if you want to look at it later, it's quite easy. So what my instrumentation library does, it prints the method enter and exit for every method which gets executed. So let's have a look at the example. So we now call our Hello World program again, and we load the instrumentation agent, and we say we want to instrument all the methods in the orgs Simonis package, and we run without intrinsification, so the output is probably as you would have expected. So we enter the main method, then we enter the say hello method, we print the output, we exit the say hello method and exit the main method. And you probably already know what the output will be when we run with the intrinsic, because now we don't actually enter these methods anymore, because the methods have been, the say hello method has been just replaced by the virtual machine. So this won't be observable by code coverage tool, for example. So besides Java instrumentation, there's also JVMTI, the Java Virtual Machine Tools Interface, which is used by profilers and debuggers, for example. It's a native interface to the Java Virtual Machine, and also we can write agents in C++ and load them at VM startup. And these JVMTA agents, they can access the Java virtual machine and inspect their state and control the execution of the virtual machine at runtime through JVMTI and Java native interface functions, JNI functions. Again, just for reference, I put the implementation of a simple tracing JVMTI agent here, and I will show you how it works. Now, so we run now the same Hello World program without intrinsification. Now the JVMTI agent, it's a shared library because it's written in C++. And again, we instrumented all the, we registered for the method enter and method exit events, and we print them on the standard out. And you see the output looks similar. We enter the methods, the say hello method, and we exit the say hello method. And if you run with intrinsification, we don't enter the say hello method anymore. So this also has effects, for example, Java debuggers. When we just start our Hello World program, for debugging, and we run in the normal mode, yes, and we say we want to debug on port 8000, and we start the program in suspended mode, then the program will listen for the debugger to attach, and now we attach with the debugger, and then we say we want to stop at the method stop in org. Yes, and then we run the program, and then we hit the breakpoint, and we can see where we are, and we continue, and everything is fine. So again, when we now enable the intrinsification of our method, and and we attach with the debugger again, and we again want to stop in the same method. You see that the breakpoint was set, so when we load the Hello World class, we get the notification and the breakpoint was set inside the class, but we never entered the breakpoint. Okay, so this is one problem, I call it observability, that we have with intrinsification, but there are also behavioral changes. So for this I prepared a small example program. You actually should just look at the compute method. It takes two arguments, a count integer, a count argument, which controls how often we enter, we execute this loop, and the seed value for the loop, and with this double value we take the sinus of it, the square root, and then we call the pole function on it, and we always add the result, count number of times, and return the result. And the main program just parses three command line arguments, and then it calls our compute function in a loop. So the reason behind this is we want to warm up this function so it gets it compiled. For this we call it with a small count number, so that we can call it 20,000 times very fast, and after that we call this compute function with a huge count argument to measure how long time it takes to execute. Okay, so let's see how this behaves. So I call it with time, just a poor man's profiler to see how long the execution of the whole program takes. I use the XX print compilation option and print inlining to see what methods get compiled and what inlining we have. And again, this is the first argument, so it's zero. It's the double argument, which is the seed for the computation. This is the count number one for the warm up. And at the end, we call the compute function with 10 million. So we executed 10 million times. So if you run this program, you see it executes pretty fast, and our compute function inlined this three function, and actually it has not inlined them, but it has intrinsified them. This is a valuable output from print inlining, so if you want to see which methods of your Java program get actually intrinsified, you can just use the print inlining option and you will see it. So if you run this program now and disable intrinsification, there is a special option for this. It's called XX minus inline mass natives. Let's see what happens. So you see we get a lot of more functions which get compiled, and when we look at our compute function, it gets compiled several times, but the last time it's here, so it inlines sinus, because now sinus is actually also a method in the class library, right? You can look at the Java implementation of it. And it inlines, and sinus calls strict mass sinus, and that's a native method. So that's implemented in C. And the same applies for square root and so on. And actually the square root implementation in C calls back to Java into the fdlib, so that's why all these methods get compiled, and it's a complicated computation of the square root or sinus, which is available on platforms which don't have mathematical floating point instructions. And you see, of course, the program takes a lot longer, like 18 seconds now. So there's a funny thing I want to mention. If you run the same program in interpreted mode with disabled intrinsics, you will see that it runs much faster than the compiled version without intrinsic, because you cannot actually disable intrinsics. You can't disable the mass intrinsics in the interpreter, so it's always fast. So this was it. And now let's look, let's extend our example a little bit. Do you know what time to save point means? So from time to time, the virtual machine has to stop all its threads to do important work like garbage collection or to clean its code heap or things like that. And for this, this cannot be done concurrently. So all the threads have to be stopped. And this is done at so-called save points. And the problem is if it takes too long time to come to a save point, your VM will block. It will not react to any external events. So I've extended the program now. We still need read the arguments like in the previous version. I just don't put it here because of place restrictions. So the new thing is this thread. First, we warm up our compute method. Then we start a new daemon thread, and all the daemon thread does is it sleeps for 1,000 seconds, and then it calls systemgc in an endless loop. And everything else, it's the same, right? So now let's see what happens. So we run without inline natives. And the output is, I would say, as expected. So about every second, you get a GC. Yes, I also run this verbose GC, so I see when a GC is actually executed. And this runs as expected. So now, if we do inline the mass natives, you will see nothing, actually. Can you see? One moment. I will clear the screen so it's easier to follow. So you actually don't see anything because there cannot happen any GC. And why is this so? For this, we have to look at the code which gets generated for JIT compiled methods. So we run our loop program and we use now another extended function. It's called compile command, and we can compile. We can control JIT compilation to a specific level, and we can also say, for example, we want to print the output of the JIT compilation. So we are now running our program. Without inlining the intrinsics. And it takes too long, one moment. Sorry for this. We have to use the pager. Excuse me? Okay, so if you look at the output without using intrinsics, we will see that this is actually compiled machine code for the compute method. And you see here, for example, there is a call to java lang strict mass square root. So this was actually the function that got inlined, which we saw before in the inlining trace. And you saw this call here, that's actually at every call there is a save point in Java. And you can see that Java saves the value of the local variables. So when a GC happens at this save point, it knows which registers or which stack slots hold objects and so on. So that's why with our Then you run without intrinsics, everything works fine, and we can get to a save point very fast. So on the other hand, if you are using intrinsics, you will see that our method is it's quite short, and that's why it executed very fast. But we have no save points anymore here, so it actually states as a comment in the generated assembly language, no JVM state info. So it's a leave call. It's not a static call like before with this runtime information, but a leave call. And for example, the square root, there isn't even a call to a Java function. This was directly translated in the XMM instructions for square root. So now we have this tight loop, which is an int loop. So int loops have no save points by default, only long loops have save points on back branches. And so this loop is executing quite long and without a save point. So this can be a problem in some applications. Okay, are there any questions so far? If not, I will proceed to say some general words about hotspot intrinsics. So all the intrinsics are defined in a big enum in this file I written in VM symbols HTTP. And the funny thing is that for a long time, this enum was restricted to 255 entries. And this was enough for about 10 years, but recently in the last years, people started to develop intrinsics for a lot of stuff. And so this was changed. Now we have 2 bytes as the intrinsic ID, and we can now code up to 64,000 intrinsics. So a lot of intrinsics, we have now a lot of intrinsics for vector instructions, for example, or for encryption, we will see that. And there are different kind of intrinsics in a hotspot. The most common ones are so-called library intrinsics. It's in intrinsics which, like our intrinsics for the Say Hello program, where we just replace a library function with a custom implementation. There also exists so-called bytecode intrinsics. That's actually not really intrinsics. It's a kind of intrinsics. It's actually instructs the hotspot not to inline special functions like, for example, string buffer function or boxing functions. So the calls remain in the intermediate representation during JIT compilation, and then at the later stage, when we have this intermediate representation graph of our compiled method, the JIT compiler does some optimizations on these calls. It detects some patterns, for example, string concatenation and things like that, and replaces them directly with intermediate language. So actually, you can only implement intrinsics for system classes. This is enforced in the virtual machine. I will show you what I had to change in the hotspot VM to implement the Say Hello World on a later slide. And since Java 9, there's also annotation in JDK internal package. It's called hotspot intrinsic candidate, and all the library functions in the JDK library, which should be inlined, are annotated with this annotation. And if you run with the XX check intrinsics option, which is on by default in a debug version of the virtual machine, the VM will detect if you don't have an implementation, an intrinsics for a function which is annotated with instance candidate, or the other way around, if you have an intrinsic for a method which is not annotated. This is because a lot of times people change like functions in the class library without adapting the intrinsics, and then they didn't work, and we got regressions. So some more words about library intrinsics. They can be implemented in different parts of the virtual machine, so in the interpreter. But obviously, for the interpreter, it's not that important to run at peak performance. So We have just a few intrinsics, like the mass intrinsics, which you should see before, or CRC32 intrinsics. We also have intrinsics in the C1 JIT compiler. It's mostly unsafe and mass intrinsics. You can see at these functions which I have noted here, there is a compiler is intrinsic supported method, which has a list of all big switch statements of all the functions which can be intrinsified by C1. And actually then in the graph builder, build graph for intrinsics, it's actually the method which replaces function calls by the intrinsic implementation. And it works actually nearly the same in the C2 compiler. There is a C2 compiler is intrinsic supported method which has a list of all the supported intrinsification methods. And there is another function library called kitry2inline, which actually does inlining for methods. And before it tries to inline a method, it checks if there is an intrinsic available. And if the intrinsic is available, it will not begin inlining, but instead replace the function call by the intrinsic implementation. And there are two ways to implement an intrinsic. You can either create new intermediate graph representation nodes for these intrinsics. We will see this in the last example, where you just replace a part of your intermediate representation with a new node, and later on this intermediate representation graph is matched against the so-called machine graph, which has the machine instructions for the abstract nodes of your compiled method. And then you also have, of course, to implement this corresponding machine node, which emits the corresponding code. So how do you control intrinsics? Especially if you see all the available functions, options which are available from controlling intrinsics, you can see that intrinsics have a very long history, because there are a lot of different functions which do actually the same. So one of the most important options is print compilation and print inlining, which we saw in the first example. You can use check intrinsics to check if actually every annotated method has an implementation, or the other way around. If this is not the case, you will get a warning like this: compiler intrinsic is defined for methods say hello, but the method is not annotated, for example. Then you can disable intrinsics with various options. So for example, you can use the disable intrinsic method option, which is the most general one, and you can use the actual enum values from VMSymbols HPP to specifically disable single intrinsics. You can use, for some intrinsics have special options like use AAS, use CRC32, and you can use this with plus and minus to enable or disable them. Then there are like general options which inline mass intrinsics, inline thread intrinsics, and so on. So now you may ask yourself, what's the difference between native methods and intrinsics? Because a lot of things which we saw can also be done with native methods. So with native methods, you can do things which are not possible in a Java. With Java semantics, you can use machine code actually. So one difference is, of course, the JVM state. Every time we call a native function by JNI, this is done through a save point. And while we are in native code in a JNI function, the virtual machine still can come to a save point and do GC or other work. This is not the case for an intrinsic, as we have seen in the loop example, where we just called a native method which computed the square the sinus of a double value, but there was no save point at this point. Also, Java and native calling conventions may be different. So you have argument marshaling, which costs some performance. And of course, you need to have a platform-dependent implementation on every platform. So with intrinsics, you usually have if you have a Java implementation for sinus, which is which you can do in pure Java. This will run on every platform. But if you declare this Sinus method native, you would have to port the native implementation on every platform. So it's still okay to have native methods for some things, especially for I/O functions, for example, which are expensive anyway. But for others, like for example mass functions, it's convenient to have intrinsics instead. So now some words about the implementation. I will now detail the implementation of the say hello intrinsic in our Hello World program. So as I told you, in VM symbols HPP, we have this big enum, which is constructed by macros, which is not very nice, but it's actually quite easy to understand. We just say we declare our class or where the method resides, which we want to intrinsify, and then we say we want to intrinsify the say hello method, which is the name of which is say hello name, and this is the signature of the method, and this is actually the name, the enum value of the intrinsics, as it will be used within the virtual machine. And you can use this idea also to disable it with the disable intrinsics option I showed you before. And then for the interpreter, the interpreter has different so-called method kinds. So you have native methods, interpreted methods, and now we have we implement a special kind of methods, which is our intrinsic for the say hello method. And then later on, when the interpreter starts to execute the method, it just checks what kind of method this method will be, and you see this is the reflected with J points, so this is what is used, what's checked by the XX plus or minus J point option. So if you run this plus J point, and our method has an intrinsic ID, which is the same like say hello, then we just return say hello world as method kind. And in the for this method kind, we generate a special method entry in the interpreter generator, and this is the actual implementation. So it's in machine code, but it's actually quite easy to understand. We load standard out. It's the actual C value of standard out to argument register 1. We load our message, which is UTF encoded string previous J point, into the second argument register, and then we do a runtime call to the fput string function, which is in the C library, and that's it. So actually, when we did run the hello world example in the interpreter, we actually, with intrinsification, we didn't call system out print line, and then we go into like inputs output stream and call some native functions. We just called this few assembler instructions. That's why it was so fast. Okay. And if you're interested, this is the hack you have to do, that you can even implement it in a non-system class, because this, in methods CPP, there is a check for the class loader being if the class loader is not zero, so it's not the system class loader, it will by default not allow you to have any intrinsics in there. So we put this check right before in, and say if we have the J point action enabled, and if we are in this class hello world, then please return our intrinsic ID, because so. This actually, it's not so easy. You cannot implement an intrinsic without changing the virtual machine. So what about implementing the C2 intrinsic? This is a little more serious. It's something you really makes sense. And I have another example here. One moment, where is it?
We have the Java util random class, and this class in the standard Java class library, and it has a next int function. And the next int function actually calls next, which is a private internal method which takes as an argument the number of bits of random bits it should return. So next in calls next with 32 bits, and we want to intrinsify this function. I have done that. I will first show you how it works, because obviously the implementation is not so interesting. So we run Java org system runtime 1,000 times, and it takes like 1.5 seconds. And when we disable the intrinsic, the next int intrinsic, and run it 10,000 times, you will see it's like about two times as long. This is not so such a big improvement as you may have expected, but the thing is that, at least if you trust Intel, this is a real random number, because it uses the render instruction which is available in new Intel CPUs, and which should, according to Intel, should really produce random numbers. And actually, if you don't use this instruction on Linux, for example, Java will use the urandom device, and this device can be blocking if you have no network traffic, for example, on your, especially on servers or even on desktop computers, no mouse movement or things like that from which you can gather entropy, then you cannot get reliable random numbers, so this can block. But this CPU instruction, it produces a lot of random numbers. So let's have a look. I will just show you this the program first. So. So the program is actually quite simple. It has a foo method which is called a count number of times, and it just calls next int on a secure random object. And we now want to see how foo is JIT compiled with and without intrinsification. So we say print compilation, print inlining. We print the output of the compilation. And we say disable intrinsic, so we will run without intrinsics. And just look for the foo method. So, and you see, again, we have inlining. So first we call next int, as we did it, as we saw in the Java source code. And next int in turn calls the next function, which in turn calls next byte, which in turn calls secure random service provider, ng next byte, which cannot be inlined, and the machine code is quite long. So if you now run with the new intrinsic, so we can disable it by simply changing the name to something which is not available. Now you can see that. Again, print inlining tells us that already next int is intrinsified, and when you look at the source code, it's quite short, and everything it does, it calls the rdrind function from which is available on the CPU, which I have in my notebook. How much time do I have? Like 10 minutes. Okay. Then I will go some in the details and explain you how this can be implemented. So we in the class library we annotate. This is now in the class library, so we don't have to hack the VM. It will be possible to intrinsify it. So we annotate the next int function with hotspot intrinsic candidate in VM symbols. Again, we declare our function name which we want to intrinsify. Now we have to do a special check on which CPU we are running, because not every Intel or AMD CPU is supporting these instructions. So actually, every time you start a CPU, you start a hotspot virtual machine, it checks all the CPU information registers to find out all the features which are available. And we added a check for this RDRAND instruction. And of course, we also have to emit this function. So the hotspot has a built-in microassembler. Maybe you know MASM, Microsoft Assembler, for example, or GNU Assembler, where you can just like C or C++ write assembler code and translate it into actual bits. And the virtual machine has something similar, because the JIT compiler has to generate bytecode. And so the just-in-time compiler has to call assembler functions. And this is in the assembler class. And we added a new method which generates our random function. And then, as I mentioned before, JIT compilation works in a way that it parses all the bytecodes and translates them into an abstract syntax tree, and it translates the bytecodes in an abstract representation. And now we create a new node, a random node, which is used to replace calls to the next int function. And on the other side, in the so-called architecture description file, we have to match this new node which we've created here. So node will be added here automatically by the matcher. So in our machine description, we match this node from the intermediate graph, and we simply emit the machine instruction for the random code. I know this is a little hard to understand. So if you're interested in this kind of stuff, I can show you a tool which is available in Hotspot. It's in the Hotspot repository. Actually, it's called Ideal Graph Visualizer, and it can be used to visualize the different steps of this graph construction and optimization. So, for example, you can look at the first, when we just parse the first bytecode, get static, you get this kind of graph. And when you execute, when you parse the next bytecode in work virtual, the graph gets already bigger, and so on. And actually, when we look before matching, that is before you match the graph against the machine representation. This is the graph 4, intrinsification. You see that the graph is already pretty nice, and you only have this this random node here, rand e node, which you've created, and this one will simply be matched into this rand e, which actually generates the machine code. So this is actually this instruction here in the architecture description file. So if you see it like a graph, it's maybe easier to understand. And if you run without intrinsics, you see that the JIT has to parses now a lot more bytecodes, because it actually inlines a lot of methods which contain bytecodes themselves. So with the intrinsification, the inlining stops, and all this is replaced by our new node. So again, here this is the first node, and let's look at the different ones. So the graph gets bigger and bigger, and when you look at the complete graph before we do the matching against the machine graphs, you can see that the graph is already quite huge, and this is a very simple method. So if you get methods which have 100,000 of nodes easily. So what I only wanted to show you here, you have a call dynamic, and if you look at the properties for this call dynamic, you can actually see that it calls, I don't know if you can read it, but I can read for it, Java Security Secure Random Service Provider Nginx Bytes. So this was actually the last function which we could not inline, because it was a virtual call. So here in the intermediate representation, you finally have a call node for this function, and if you open the version which has the matched version against the machine graph, you will have here somewhere the corresponding you have here this call. It's now in machine graph speak, it's now called dynamic Java direct. So this will actually execute the emit the call instruction, and it's actually a call to the same function. And you can also see here that the JIT compiler find out that it has a not zero byte array as argument, which is always bigger than zero, and so on. So that's actually all. I have all the example code and the slides on GitHub. I uploaded them last month at Jailbreak, so the few changes I've made for today, I will upload today in the evening, so if you get the latest version, you can look at it if you're interested. So thanks a lot, and I will be happy to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Volker.
First of all, thanks a lot for your presentation. It was really brilliant. I enjoyed it.
Thanks.
Well, are there any restrictions for the methods that can be intrinsified?
No, actually, I'm not aware of. You can intrinsify every method, but as I told you, you always have to be aware of the problems I told you. So, for example, now a lot of the encryption algorithms get intrinsified because modern CPUs like Spark or Intel or PowerPC, they have powerful instructions for AES, for example, or CRC. And if you intrinsify such methods, the intrinsified code can run for quite a long time, and you have no save point during this. So this may be one problem. Also, you have to be very cautious that the functionality provided by the CPU matches exactly the semantics of the Java method which you intrinsify. So like 5 or 6 years ago, Hotspot had a lot of problems with intrinsified float functions because, for example, the interpreter on C1 and C2, they called different C functions or used the one used the XMM instructions, the other used the old MMU instructions. So if you did some floating point computation, it could be you had a loop and you had a floating point, you always computed the same sinus, for example. And where you did it interpreted, you called, for example, the C function, the C library. And later on, when you get to the C2 compiler, it used the XMM instructions, and it had just other rounding modes. So you suddenly your results could change during execution, which the Java developer has not expected such results. So you have to be very cautious that the semantics is the same.
Okay, and what about the arguments that I can pass to the intrinsified method? For example, can I pass just heap objects?
Yeah, there is no restriction. So this was a very simple example which take no arguments, but actually in this you are working on the intermediate representation graph, and you have all the arguments as abstract extract entities, as abstract nodes. So you can do anything the JIT compiler has to do anyway with nodes. So there is no restriction on arguments.
But there should be some impact on GC, right? As far as the no save point can be reached during the intrinsified method is called.
That's why you don't have to care about objects in the heap, because you cannot come to a save point. So while your intrinsic is executed, there can be no save point, so you don't have to care about registering your object somewhere.
And what if it should be the object that is passed should be...
Maybe we can discuss it later in the expert zone. There was one more question here.
Just last question.
Regarding save points, can I, inside my intrinsic implementation, add an explicit save point poll?
If you implement the intrinsics in the intermediate representation graph, you can put a save point inside, yes. But for example, if you just replace your intrinsic with a call to a native implementation, a static call, as it was done with the say hello method, then there is no way to do that. So it depends how you implement the intrinsic.
Okay. Thank you very much, Volker, again.